Praise the Lord. Good evening to all in Radio Land. You're listening to Choice Radio on 92.9 FM. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Today, we just want to let you know that Jesus Christ is Lord and He is God over all. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. He just wants you to know that God is in charge, and He wants you to know that there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. As we listen this evening, I just want you to open up your hearts to the Word of God today, because there's something for someone to break every chain. Praise the Lord. Good afternoon. This is 92.9 FM Choice Radio, and we are listening to this evening broadcast of Salvation and Revelation. Shall we pray? Father, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we come before you, O God, a mighty God, a great God, a wonderful God, a Savior. Lord, Father, we come before your throne of grace. We ask you, O God, Father, Lord God, so, O God, Father, wash us white as snow. We ask you, O God, even as we come before your presence, that whatever is said today would be glorifying to your name, O God, would bring honor to you, O God, and that some life will be changed for good and for eternity in the name of Jesus. I ask you, O God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable unto you, my God, my Savior, and my Redeemer. And even as I speak this teaching and preach your word, that, O God, I too shall take my portion to live a better life for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We say thank you, O God, for that one who's going to say yes to you, too, Lord. So we bless you and we thank you. O God, Father, Lord God, as on earth as it is in heaven, we accept you, O God, Father, your word as the final truth. And as we share it, O God, I ask you to break every chain in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. My name is Evangelist Jennifer Pope, and I am coming before you this evening to read the word of God, to teach and to preach what God has laid on my spirit. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Revelation chapter 19, and we are reading from verse 1 to verse 9. Amen. Praise the Lord. The word of the Lord is already blessed. It says, "And after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Alleluia, Savior, and glory, and honor, and power unto the Lord our God. For true and righteous are the judgments, for he has judged the great whore, which did corrupt the earth with her fornication, and has avenged the blood of his servants at her hand." And again they said, "Hallelujah, hallelujah!" And her smoke rose up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four beasts fell down and worshipped God that sat on the throne, saying, "Amen, hallelujah." And a voice came out of the throne saying, "Praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great." And I heard as if it was the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of many mighty thundering, saying, "Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him. For the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. And he said unto me, Write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said it unto me, These are the true saints of God." Praise the Lord. Amen. These are the true saints of God. Praise the Lord. There's no God like Jehovah. He's coming again. Jesus is coming back for you. He wants you to be ready for his marriage supper. He's coming back. You have to be ready. He wants a prepared people. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. But you must accept him as Lord and Savior. Holy comes. Jesus is coming again. And even as we look at the word of God and we read that he's coming, and we have to be ready, we have to be prepared. And how do we get prepared? By coming to him and asking him to forgive us for all our sins, that we accept his son Jesus Christ, we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, that we know that he's the only way, the only truth, and the only life. He is the life, he is the truth, and he is the way. And even as we look at the word of God this evening, we know that there are things that are happening in the universe. And you may say that happens for generations, it had happened before, but signs of the times are everywhere. And as we look into these words in Revelation, we see that he's coming back again. And we look at the wars, rumors of wars, chaos everywhere. And it's happened before, but as the time is drawing closer, you have to make sure that your salvation is not denied because you did not accept Jesus Christ. He said, I placed before you life and I placed before you death. And he says, choose life. And today we want to look at a supper that was prepared for someone who strayed away. And this is what we're going to look at today. It's going to be in Luke chapter 15, verse 12, the story of the prodigal son. Amen. There's a parable in there that we need to look at very closely as it relates to our lives. And many times we have situations where we want everything and we want it now. We live in a system and in a place where we have everything is at hand. You want something microwaved, you put it in the microwave. We have instant food, instant everything, and everything is just at the tip of your computer, your laptop, you know, your notebook. You just get any information. And so it is in the natural, it is in the spirit. Sometimes we want everything right away, but everything has a divine time and purpose. And sometimes we can get in a situation where we think that, okay, these things that I want right now, God is not helping me. God is distant from me. I am distant from God. So I'm trying to get everything, you know, I'm in the land of opportunity. I'm in the land of America. Or maybe you might be in a distant land and you think you want everything right now. And when it does not give, you do not get it right now, it could be frustrating. But the word of God said, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall rise up with wings like an eagle. Amen. And so many things that are there to want us that want instant gratification, instant results, and we have to wait on God. Amen. We have to wait on the Father. He is the one who is in control of our lives. And he said, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Today you may not know God, Jesus Christ, as your Lord and Savior. You may not know the Father as your Heavenly Father. You maybe not know what it is to walk with the power of the Holy Spirit living inside of you, which is the Spirit of God. And today you have a divine opportunity that as we look at this this parable of the prodigal son, we see how does this fit into my life? How does this story fit into this generation where I'm at this point? Revelation is coming closer and closer in terms of its fulfillment, and we see so many things. Sooner than later, we will be under one world government. We will be under all the things that we will have problems to buy and sell, and all those other things that show you that Jesus is the Holy Spirit will be lifted off of the earth, and then you will not have the opportunity to give your heart to Christ. So today, now is the accepted time. Now is the moment of salvation. He said, if I come and I knock, do not be afraid. Open your heart to the Lord this evening and he will come in. Amen. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 15, and we are reading from verse 11. And it reads as follows. And he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to him, Father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And then he was spent, when he had spent all, then he arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain fulfill his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? And I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring me forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again, and he was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Amen. Praise the Lord. From verse 12 to 24, we stop right there. Father, Lord God, I ask you, O God, to send your anointing, O God, send your Holy Spirit to rightly divide your word of truth. And, O God, as somebody, O God, who is listening, someone, O God, many, O God, who have listened, who have tuned in today, Father, Lord God, they will know you as Lord and Savior in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So it is and so it shall be. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. We said this young man, like many of us, we want everything instantly. We want everything immediately. And when we don't get everything immediately, we want to take it by force. Amen? And God wants us to know that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. You may be looking for a job opportunity. You may be looking for maybe children in your marriage. You may be looking for, you know, your condition to change from lack to overflow. You may be looking for maybe release from problems, family issues, you know, social issues, different things that may be bombarding you, stress on the job. And you're saying, when is this going to end? You know, you have a supervisor who maybe is breathing down your neck, and every day you're saying, when is this going to end? But God is in control. But he wants, first of all, to invite you to have fellowship with him, because he says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all other things shall be added unto you. Amen? So this young man knew that he had a heritage. He had an inheritance. He had something that was prepared for him. He had another brother. He was the younger one. And he said, listen, Father, give me my portion. I want it instantly. I want to be blessed right now. And God has some blessings for you. And they are held back because he wants to get you to the level of salvation. Or you are saved already. He wants you to get you to the level of long suffering, or maybe to a deeper sense of love, or to bring you to the fruit of peace, the part of the fruit of peace in your life, to birth the fruit of the Spirit in you. He wants you to become more gentle, kinder. Whatever is the issue that he's trying to bring you to, the time and the purpose and the season for his blessing is not yet. What do you do? Sometimes we run ahead of God and decide, guess what? I'm taking it by fire and by force. And God wants you to know that he wants you to wait on him. He wants you to accept him as head of your life, because he knows what's best for you and the time in which he's going to bless you. But he wants to give you the gift of salvation on tonight if you do not know him as Lord and Savior. This young man, he wanted his inheritance now. And his father says, listen, you want it, there it is. He gave it to him. Because sometimes God don't argue with us, because he set his laws, his commandments, his precepts, his statutes, and we have to adhere to them. But when we don't, he just sometimes wait and look and observe, because he's everywhere, he sees everything, and he wants you to come home to him and to inquire of him and to be your source, your divine source. Amen? Your main source. Amen? He doesn't want you to be self-sufficient. He doesn't want you to run ahead of him. But he wants you to accept his son, Jesus Christ, as a Lord and Savior. This young man took his portion of his inheritance and he ran away to a far country. The word of God said he went to a far country. Why did he go to a far country? Because he didn't want his father to find him. Also, he did not want his father to know what he was doing. Because when he went to that far country, he went and engaged himself in riotous living, you know, with women, partying, and just having a jolly good time. This young man detached himself from his father. And so it is at tough times that sometimes we detach ourselves from the Father, the Heavenly Father, the one that we used to pray to, the one that we used to love, the one that we used to trust. And because now we are in a situation where we can have certain things by ourselves, because we forgot that Jesus Christ is Lord, we put, you know, a deaf ear to the fact that God is calling us and saying, I want you to fellowship with me, because we feel that then we may have a job, we may have money, we may have education, and all those blessings that God the Father gave to us because we ask. We ask him, and we said to him, God, Lord Father, I want you to bless me in school. I want to go to college. I want to become this profession, or I want you to give me this job. I want you to give me this husband. I want you to give me this wife. Whatever we have asked for, he has given it to us freely. He did not argue. But then, in him giving us, we forgot about him. And we forgot that we had asked him. And sometimes we go far away from his presence, and he's waiting for us to come to our senses, as we see here. This young man wasted his substance in righteous living. And when he had spent all, there was a big famine, scarcity of money. He didn't have any women around him then, because everybody left him. So then he went and joined himself to a citizen. Verse 15, St. Luke's Gospel 15, verse 15. He went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the field to feed swine. Now this is the son of a rich man who has given him his inheritance. And instead of him taking that inheritance, investing it, or doing something positive with it, he went partying and he went with women. And this is the scenario of a wasted life. He wasted his substance on righteous living. But God did not forget about him. God did not scratch him out. His father remembered him. And we see, he said, give me the portion of goods. Amen. Give me the portions of goods that falleth to me. He knew he was entitled to his father's fortune. He did not work for that father's fortune. But he knew, as a son of that man, he knew that he was entitled to his inheritance. And God has a great inheritance for us. It's wrapped up in our salvation, accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And we are entitled to the benefits of salvation, but we must meet the requirement. We must accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. He knew he was entitled to his father's fortune. He asked, and it was given to him. The word of God said, ask, and it shall be given to him, to us. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto us. And he said, if our earthly father is giving to his son good gifts, which was his fortune in this case, wouldn't our heavenly father give us much more? God wants us to know this evening that he loves us, and he wants to give us good things in our lives. He wants us to embrace, first of all, his son Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. If you have strayed away and you have gone into a far country, and of your far country, it might be your friends, it might be drugs, it might be rebellion, it might be money and greed. Your far country might be the enticing of the things of the world that draw you away from the Lord. It might be sin that so easily beset us. It might be you yourself falling into pride. Amen. Because now you have arrived, because you have everything that you want. So now you get prideful. You get, you know, it may be some disappointment even that may draw you away, you know, and you go into a far place, far from God, because you think he does not care anymore. It may be despair because you have rising bills, you have mortgage, you have all these things that pull in you, and then you don't see how it's going to happen. But instead of drawing close to the master, you run away into a far place, and you go into depression, you go into anxiety, you go into fear, and you're in this far country of those things, and God is there waiting for you to come home. It might be guilt of something that you have done wrong, and the enemy has driven you into a far country, a place where you can't hear from God, where you think that God is not hearing you and he's not seeing you. But he says he knows everything about you. He knows every hair on your head. He knows you from before you were in your mother's womb. When it is dark, it is still light unto him, according to Psalm 139. Where can you go from his presence? His presence is watching you. His father was not physically in that far country with him, but his father never gave up on him. And we'll see that in a moment. He said here that in verse 15, he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. Amen. He left his father home with security, with servants, with provision. And he went spent everything he had, and now he's in a place of lack, depravity, of not having friends, you know, lonely and also hungry. And he wants you to have a hunger for him this afternoon, for God, for his son Jesus Christ. He was hungry. He was physically hungry. Are you spiritually hungry this afternoon for the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Do you have a need that only God can fix? Well, this young man knew he had a need, and he knew that his father could fix that need, but he had to make some decisions. See, every good and perfect gift comes from the Father. The Father gave him his perfect gift, which was his inheritance. But he took that inheritance and he used it the wrong way. What are we, have we been given by the Lord, and we are using it in the wrong way? If you know God as your Savior, he has given you gifts. He has given you talents. He's given you abilities, and he has given you his word. How are you using those gifts? Are you using it, wasting it? Or is it lying dormant? Or are you doing something with it? So you can hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." This young man said he would. He went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his field to feed swines. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swines did eat, and no man gave unto him. He was in a place where he was alone. He was empty. He was isolated from everyone. His family, the friends that he was partying with, and he was in a stranger's house in a foreign country. He took himself into that far place. No one sent him there. He said he journeyed into a far country in verse 13 of Luke 15. God wants you to draw near to him. He doesn't want you to go so far from him that you have to journey to get back. He wants you to draw near to him. He said if you draw near to him, he will draw near to you. To remain in him, he wants you to stay in him. His father wanted him to be with him. His other son was with him. He did not leave. But he wanted to go his own journey and to have a good time. And many times this is the condition of man wanting to journey and to do our own thing. He made choices to move away from his presence, the presence of his father. And we too make choices to move away from the presence of our Master and Savior Jesus Christ, of our Lord and King, God Almighty, from the presence of the Holy Spirit speaking to us. Amen? And this evening, he wants you to come back to him. If you have backslidden, if you had known God and his son Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that he sent his son to die for you, and you strayed away from him, today he wants to bring you back home from that far place that you have sojourned. So now you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. He wants you to accept him tonight. As we look at the prodigal son, we see some things that maybe the Holy Spirit, I am trusting God, will speak to you tonight, and you will just surrender your heart to him. He said on verse 17, and when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? He's looking at himself now, and he's saying, wait a minute, my father has servants who have more than I have now, and much more to spare, and here am I eating the pig's food. Amen? That's a really low place to be. And no matter how low you have fallen, no matter how down you may feel, no matter how you think that there is nothing else left, God is saying to you, come home. Come home to me tonight. Come home, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He wants to rest your spirit, man. All those things that is bringing you so far into those far places, he wants to disconnect you from that foreign thing that is part of your life. Amen? He wants to bring you in a place where he has fellowship with you, communion with you, that you can feel his presence and come into his presence with thanksgiving and with joy. All these situations remove us from enjoying having a personal relationship with the Father. All the things that take us into this far place, it prevents the presence of God from really coming into our lives. Amen? God stays waiting. His presence is there, but he's waiting for you to come. Amen? He attached himself to the wrong source. He was not a citizen of that far country. And many times we attach ourselves to the wrong source. Amen? which made him a foreigner. He was a foreigner. No matter how he joined himself to that person, that person, that citizen, looked at him as a foreigner. If not, he might have given him a place in his house and say, listen, I want to train you. I want to show you some things and I want to employ you. But instead, he gave him the menial task of feeding swines because he saw him as a foreigner. He was not part of that country. He looked at him as an alien resident. And you are an alien resident when you are not in the presence of God. You have stepped out of your citizenship with Christ when you have backslidden from his presence. Amen? When you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are in a foreign land, a land that he wants to pull you from and bring you back to him as it was in the beginning, so it shall be in the end. He attached himself to the wrong source. His status as heir to his father's house was not lost. He still was the son of a great man. He had a great father who had an inheritance that he gave to him. But now he is a servant. He made himself a servant and a slave to a foreigner because of those bad choices that he made. But he made a decision. And he said, he came to himself in verse 17. And we have to come to a place where we have to look into ourselves and see where we are with the Lord. Amen? We have to look into ourselves, into our spirit man. Look at our lives and say, am I in the right place? He came to himself. He saw his condition. But one good thing about that prodigal son, is that he acknowledged that he had sinned and he had a desire to do something about it. So he acknowledged it. And many times, sometimes we say, yes, I need God. Yes, I need Christ in my life. We acknowledge that we need him, but we don't do anything about it because we think we have so much time. Time is in the hands of the Lord. Amen? Time is not in our hands. No one knows tomorrow. We say tomorrow, God's willing. If it's his will, he will bring it to pass. Amen? That we'll have it tomorrow. But time is in his hands. And he says in his word, no one know when he comes. Amen? He might come or you might go to him and you do not want to go to a Christless eternity without your father. Amen? He made a decision to run to his father's house. Amen? He wanted to return to his father's house. And God wants to bring you back into fellowship with him for those who have stepped away. And God wants to bring you into fellowship with him to his son Jesus Christ, with those who have not accepted him as Lord and Savior. He confessed that he had sinned against his father and against heaven. Amen. And in verse 19, he saw himself unworthy of his father's forgiveness. He saw himself as being unworthy because he knew he made serious mistakes. He detached himself, he went very far away, and he did not connect with his father. Nowhere in the Bible it showed that he was in touch with his father. But he knew the way back home. Amen? And you have to know the way back home. The way back home to the Lord, if you have not given your life to Christ, is through the blood of Jesus. Amen? Through accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You have access to the Heavenly Father. There is only one way, one truth, and one life, and it's in Christ Jesus. There is no other way in which you can connect to a Heavenly Father, which is God Almighty, only through his Son, Jesus Christ. He sent his Son to die for you so that you will have eternal life, that you will be saved, that you will experience heaven, your eternal home, and that you will have above what you can ask or think, even in this life and the life to come. Amen? He arose and came to his father. And when he said, I will arise, in verse 18, and go to my father and will say unto him, he had a confession to make. And, you know, he said, Father, I have sinned, he acknowledged, against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. He saw his state as being a sinner. And make me as one of your hired servants. He was showing humility there. Amen? And he arose and came to his father, verse 20, Luke 15, verse 20. He rose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. What a father. Amen? His father, he decided he's going to go home. And his going home, he did not know that his father was on the lookout for him. His father did not know when he's coming home, but his father expected him to show up at some point, because his father still loved him. His father still wanted to bless him, and his father had an expectation of him coming to his senses. Amen? So when he was a far distance, his father saw him coming. Amen? He saw him in the distance. He said, when he arose, when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him. Amen? And sometimes when we are so far away from God and so far away from what God wants to require from our lives, we think that he has forgotten us. But he's seen us from a distance. Amen? Because he's everywhere. He's omnipresent. He's with you in that far country of depression, in that far country of frustration, in that first country of pride, in that far country of just having a good time and forgetting about God. Amen? He's in that far country. He's looking. Amen? He's everywhere, and he's the only wise God. He knows that your name has been written in his book of life, because he knows the end from the beginning. That's why he's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. So he said in his word, if you draw close to me, I will draw close to you. So that young man had to make an effort and decide, I'm going home. And God wants you to make a decision today that you are coming home to him today. You're going to put him first place in your life, and everything else shall be added on to you. Amen. The son said to his father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him. First, his father did something. He did so, well, actually, the son did something. He arose and went to see his father. He wanted to change. He wanted to change his situation and his condition. And you must know when enough is enough. Aren't you tired of doing things your own way? Aren't you tired of just living any old how? You know, just having no one to trust, no one to lean on? Because you have a savior. You have a counselor. You have a high priest. You have a father. You have a brother. You have Jesus Christ, who died for you, gave up his life for you. And he have not forgotten you. He's still on the lookout for you coming home. His neck, he said, yeah, the son was a great distance away. His father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck. So he had compassion, which is a great love. Amen. And he ran to him and he fell on his neck. So as we make an effort to come to Christ and to go to the Father and to come to him, to ask him to forgive us our sins, God will draw near to you. Amen. Through the power of the Holy Spirit. No one's come to the Father unless the Spirit draws him. And the Holy Spirit is drawing you tonight. You know, he says to you, come. Come tonight. Make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. This son, the father said, he said, hey, my son is coming home. And he saw him, he had compassion, he ran and he fell on his neck. The neck is a symbol of strength. And the joy of the Lord is our strength. This father was joyful. Amen. And he wanted to share that joy with his son. So he embraced him, and he didn't lift him up, but he fell on his neck. Amen. He embraced him, and the neck is symbolic of strength. Amen. So he wanted to give him strength. Amen. And it's also a symbol of humility, right? Hardness of spirit, you know, to strengthen in him, because he wanted to encourage him. He ran to him. He was showing him affection and concern. And he was showing him, I forgave you. Because he would not have run to him when he saw him. He ran to him. He was showing him that he forgave him. And God is showing you through his word tonight that he has forgiven you. Every guilt, every stain, he has forgiven you. Amen? The son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called the son. Even though that we sometimes stray from God, and God knows our shortcomings, he knows our sins, our sins are ever before him, he says in his word, I'm willing to forgive you, because he's long-suffering, he's merciful, he's a kind God. And so he said, surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. So no matter what state you are in, God's mercies endures forever over your life. The father said to his servant, bring the best robe. A robe is a symbol of a covering. Amen? Covering. It symbolizes covering. And if you have, because of time, we're not going to go into that scripture. But in Isaiah 61 verse 10, you can look at that. It's a covering. Amen? In Revelation 6:11, we see the covering. We know he's our covering. Amen? He covers us with his own hands. The robe was a symbol of him covering him. So no matter how he had sinned and messed up and he had done wrong, he was, his father's love covered him. And that is how it have to be. It should be. Love covers a multitude of sins. Amen? He said to his servant, put it on him. He covered all his sins and put a ring on his hands. That's how God, that's what the Father does for us when we accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. He gave him a ring. What does the ring symbolize? The ring is a symbol of eternity. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we are comparing this earthly father to our heavenly father here. This ring that he gave him, this is what God gives to us when we accept Jesus Christ. He gives us the access to eternity. Amen? He gives us access to eternity. Also, authority. A ring is authority. Amen? Power in another's name. There's power in the name of Jesus. So now, when we accept Jesus Christ, we have his name. Amen? We have his name. We have his blood covering us. Amen? We have a new name written in glory. Amen? And we have the authority to access the throne of grace through Jesus Christ. Amen? Because now, that ring gives us an authority. Amen? That blood covering. So he has, first of all, he has the next, the strength. His father embraced him, had compassion on him, ran to him to show him that he forgave him. And then he said, here is a robe, like I'm covering up your sins. And he said, hey, I'm giving you a ring, which is eternal promise. Eternity, I'm not going to stop loving you. You have access to my house. You have access to me again. And God is giving you access to his kingdom again tonight. He's giving you another chance to say, yes, Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. And he says here, he put it on him and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. The shoes, which is a symbol of walker, you know, treading a new path. He's going into a new place in Christ, in with his father. And we go into a new place with Christ, with Jesus, when we accept him. He gives us a new shoes because now we're supposed to walk differently. The things that we used to do, we don't want to do them no more. So we want to walk differently. This word become a lamp unto our feet and a light to our path. He wants us to take a new walk by putting on new shoes. We have a new shoes and we have the gospel of the word of God, the gospel of salvation. We have the Bible giving us the blueprint as how we shall walk differently. So the father equipped him for a new life. I said, and bring hither the fattest calf. Amen. A calf is a symbol of praise and thanksgiving. So he said, get the best one. And God, whenever Jesus has accepted one soul, he said he leaves 99 to go after one soul. When one soul says yes to the Father, that you have accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, guess what happens? Angels are rejoicing in heaven. They are giving praise to God. They are thanking God that someone came home to him today. And so it is, it symbolizes the rejoicing that takes place in heaven when a soul comes to the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Your name is written in heaven and you have a new name written in glory. So now all these things that this father was doing, the word of God is showing us through this parable. Jesus was teaching this parable and he's showing us how he, the father, can accept us as we come back to him, to Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ, when we come to him, even the blessings that we got before, we got house and land and education and money and all those things that he gave us, even outside of his name, because we didn't accept him yet, but he still bless us. Amen. He's saying to you, when you strayed into that far country, I gave you what was your portion. I've given you some blessing. But now that you're coming to me and you want to accept me as Christ my son as Jesus Christ, the Lord, the Savior, your Savior, your personal Savior, to have fellowship with Jesus Christ, my son. I want to give you all the benefits that are more lasting even. It's available for you. It's already there for you, but I'm bestowing it on you now because now I'm giving you, number one, my strength. Amen? Symbolizing the neck that the Father laid on the prodigal son. I'm giving you a robe, which is a new covering. Amen? Now you're covered by the blood of Jesus, that no weapon formed against you shall prosper in the name of Jesus, that you are covered. Amen? You have moved to a new city. You have moved from a foreign country into the city of heaven. Amen? To the country of heaven. Amen? You are now the child of the Most High God, because guess what? You have been found now. He said in his word that once you were lost, now you are found. We are found when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. He went and died on Calvary for you. He shed his blood for you, and he rose from the grave. He sits at the right of the Father, hand of the Father, making intercessions for you. And tonight, he's showing you that this ring that this Father gave to the Son is an eternal covenant. Amen? Eternity, endlessness, authority he has given you through the power of the Holy Spirit when you say yes to Christ. Amen? He's also showing you that he's giving you a new shoes. He wants you to walk differently. Amen? So the things that the prodigal son lost, now that the Father gave him all those things, amen, he gave him a party, he killed the fattest calf, and he had a celebration, a party for him. All those things take place when you give your life to Christ Jesus. You have a new walk, you have an eternal promise, you have a new covering. You are not covered by a foreigner. You're not outside of God. You are not covered by Satan. You have a covering, which is Jesus Christ. You are not in a foreign land anymore. You are in the kingdom of the Most High God. Amen? You are sitting in heavenly places with Christ Jesus in the spirit realm. And he wants to do all those things. He wants to give you his strength. He said his grace is sufficient, that when you are weak, he's making you strong. No matter what it is that you're going through tonight, and you feel that you are so far away from God, he wants you to know today that he is waiting. He has expectation. He's waiting and he's on the lookout for you. He's not going to give up because you've strayed away. He didn't forget you because you are not praying. You are not worshiping him. You are not thanking him. You don't remember him when you get up in the morning. You don't remember him when you go to bed at night. He have not forgotten you. He is still on the lookout for you. And he wants you to come to him in childlike faith, in humility, acknowledging that you have sinned, acknowledging that you have messed up, but knowing who you are in Christ Jesus, who you are capable of coming because of his blood, who is there waiting for you, the eternal God who have sent his son Jesus Christ to die for you. He wants you to know that he has not forgotten you, that he's on the lookout for you, and he's running you as you pull yourself up from your situation, from your depression, from your anxiety, from your fears, and from the things that is bombarding you, that Satan is telling you that you cannot accept Jesus because you have done this and you have done that. God is waiting for you. Jesus is standing and he's knocking at your door and he's saying to you, come in. Amen? Come in. I'm opening that door of salvation. All you have to do is accept me, admit, for, like that prodigal son, that you are a sinner and that you need forgiveness, that you believe that Jesus Christ died in your place and he paid the penalty for your sin, that you are willing right now to turn your sins and accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and your Lord, and commit yourself, and he wants you to invite the Holy Spirit to come into your heart. When you admit that you're a sinner and you ask God to forgive you, as that prodigal son did, guess what? The prodigal son asked. He knew what he was going to say before he saw his father. And you know what you have to say to God. You can use this story in Luke 15. Go back to it and say, you can say what that prodigal son said. Father, I have sinned against you, Father, and against heaven. But you go a step further. I accept you, Lord Jesus Christ, as my Lord and Savior. I confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I confess with my mouth and I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. Whatever chains that is holding you this evening, preventing you from coming to Christ, preventing you from experiencing the gift of salvation, that eternal promise, amen? That ring that the Father gave to his prodigal son, he did not see him as prodigal anymore. He saw a son that he loved and that he was waiting for with open arms, that he might have been old, but he ran to him and he had compassion, which is such deep love, and he gave him strength. He embraced him at the neck, signifying strength. God wants to embrace you. He wants to hug you. He wants you to create in you a clean heart and a right spirit. He wants you to know that his love is eternal, and he wants to give you eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. Shall we pray? Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you, O God. And for that one who have heard this, O God, your word being, O God, exposed to them tonight. O God, Father, I ask you, O God, to meet that one at the point of their need. If they do not know you as Lord and Savior, as they confess with their mouth, Jesus Christ is Lord. I ask you, O God, Father, to embrace that one, to write that one name in heaven, O God, to give them your eternal promise of salvation, O God, to put, O God, your blood upon that one, O God. O God, cover them in your blood, O God. Father, Lord God, you went to Calvary, O God, and you die, O God, and even as you cover them tonight in your blood, I ask you to take away every sin, O God, anything that easily beset them, O God, anything that will bring them into a far country, oh God. Oh God, Father, disconnect them from that far land, oh God. Oh God, Father, of sin, of shame. Oh God, Father, Lord God, of, oh God, all the things that separate them, you know them right well. And I ask you, oh God, to create in them, oh God, your heart, oh God, create a clean heart and a right spirit. Send your Holy Spirit to live inside that one. And I decree that heaven is your eternal home. Angels are rejoicing as you say yes to Jesus tonight. Every fetter is broken. Every chain is broken. Break every chain, oh God, and bring them to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ through your word. We rejoice, O God, tonight, for someone tonight has said yes to you as your word went forth. We say thank you, Lord, for salvation for your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. He has come for you today. You have heard the word. Harden not your heart. I believe by faith that you have accepted Jesus Christ. Angels are rejoicing over you. You have been listening to 92.9 Choice Radio Gospel Network. Continue listening. Holy Spirit will continue to speak to you. Tune in on Saturday morning at 9 a.m. when we continue Salvation and Revelation. I've been listening to Evangelist Jennifer. God bless you. Start reading your Bible, find yourself a Bible believing church, and get to know the Lord through the Word of God. Jesus loves you. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Jesus is coming back. Don't miss out on your salvation. Signs of the times are everywhere. read your word. Matthew 24. We love your Choice Radio Network Gospel. Sharing the truth of the word, uncompromised. Let's come in. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus is Lord. The only way.